morning, hometown. We're so glad you're here with us this morning. A special welcome to anybody who's new and joining us streaming for the first time. We're so glad you're here. Today, we're going to kick off a new series called Persevere, which is going to talk about standing strong in really hard times. One thing that's really helped me in the past few weeks is just worshiping Jesus and spending time with him, and we're going to do that right now. So please join us to sing. The lyrics will be at the bottom of the screen, and we're going to have an awesome time of worship. Then we'll have Pastor Spencer share a great message with us, pray, and sing a little bit more. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day and that we could be here and join together through this amazing gift of technology. I ask that you would just be with us, that the Holy Spirit would come wherever we are through this city in every living room, Lord, and that you would just bring glory through this service. In Jesus' name, amen.
That I face, and stronger than the power of the grave, a constant in the trial and the change, this one thing remains. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love. And on and on and on it goes. Yes, it overwhelms and satisfies my soul, and I never ever have to be afraid, 'cause this one thing remains, this one thing remains. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love. In death, in life, I'm confident, I'm covered by the power of your great love. And my debt is paid, there's nothing that can separate my heart from your great love. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. And on and on and on it goes. Yes, it overwhelms and satisfies my soul, yeah. And I never ever have to be afraid, 'cause this one thing remains. Your love never fails, it never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love, it's your love.
I count on one thing, the same God who never fails. You won't fail me now, you won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will. That never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. Same God who never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand against. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name.
Give life, you are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath.
I was 12 years old, and in gym class, we were going to run the 600-yard dash, and I'd never run that far before. So the way that the gym teacher did it was he divided the class into two halves, and I was in the second half, so I watched the first half run the 600-yard dash, and I noticed that there were a few kids out front, the faster kids, and then there's a few kids sort of trailing behind, but in the middle was the crowd, the clump of kids all running together. And I thought to myself, well, all I got to do is make sure I stay with the crowd. So then it got to be time for the second half. So we lined up and we started running our 600-yard dash. And I stayed with the crowd. And I had a good start. And then my sides started to hurt. And I thought, I just have to power through this, you know? So I kept running. And the more I ran, the more my side hurt. And as hard as I tried, next thing I knew, the crowd was in front of me. And then a little while later, the slow kids were in front of me. And I actually crossed the finish line holding my side, walking dead last. But I started strong. You know, all of us are in a time where we have to endure. You know, we're all living through inconveniences and difficulties, some severe. And now is a time when we have to endure. And that's why we're doing this series called Persevere. Because this crisis that we're in, we don't know how long it's going to last. And it may linger for quite some time. So we need to persevere through this. And today we are talking about specifically how to endure, endurance, because endurance is a big deal to our Lord. I want to show you three verses. The first verse about endurance tells us that God has a special blessing for us when we endure. It goes like this. From James chapter 1, it says, God blesses those who patiently endure testing and temptation. Afterward, they will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. In this next verse, we see that endurance is part of the very definition of what love is. From 1 Corinthians 13, it says this, love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. In this next verse, we see that endurance is such an important thing that we should be joyful when we're in a situation that forces us to develop more endurance. Here's the verse. From Romans chapter 5, it says, we can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, for we know that they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. So we see that endurance is a big deal to our Lord. Well, this brings us to the book of Hebrews. The book of Hebrews was written to believers, to Christians, with a Jewish background. But they were living through a very difficult time. They weren't living through a pandemic, but they were living through persecution for their faith. And their faith was starting to suffer because of it. They were starting to fade. And there's a couple of verses in the book of Hebrews that point us to that. I'll show you two. The first one says this from Hebrews chapter 6. So let us stop going over the basic teachings about Christ again and again. Let us go on instead and become mature in our understanding. Surely we don't need to start again with the fundamental importance of repenting from evil deeds and placing our faith in God. You see, in our faith, we are either going forward or falling back. And here we see sort of a frustration on the part of the writer, which most Bible experts believe was probably Paul. We see frustration that the believers of the Hebrew church were stagnant, which means that they were actually kind of falling back in their faith. Or this next verse shows us something else from Hebrews chapter 10. It says, let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. So what we see here is they're starting to not make gathering together a priority. So we see that their faith is starting to dim in the face of this difficult time. And the same thing can happen with us. If this pandemic stretches on for a while, you know, difficulty in our life can sometimes make us turn away or neglect the things of God when we become preoccupied with worry or stress or thoughts about the situation we're in. Or sometimes when life is difficult, we can even get to the point of questioning God's goodness or even doubting that he exists. So how do we endure? How do we stand strong? You know, if you were to ask me that, you know, especially when I was a kid, I would say we endure by gritting our teeth and trying harder. I remember coaches used to tell me that. I remember running laps in track and the coach would say, tough it out. And we can kind of bring that attitude into this context, but the Bible doesn't teach us to grit our teeth and tough it out. Instead, Scripture inspires us. We're going to look at a short passage from the 10th chapter of Hebrews, and we're going to see three sources of inspiration that can help you to endure no matter what happens. So starting with verse 32, we find this. Think back on those early days when you first learned about Christ. You know, since this pandemic started, I find myself watching network news more. In fact, I never watched it before, but now I watch it every day. And one thing I've noticed is they often have feature stories about our frontline workers, especially our frontline medical workers. And these stories are inspiring because they put themselves at risk in order to help others. They don't walk away. They stay in there. And these stories are inspiring. Now, let's compare that to Jesus. Jesus did a lot more than just put himself at risk. He knew full well that when he came down into this world, his creation as a man, that he would go to the cross and die a torturous death. And not only would he endure the physical pain, but he would also endure the emotional and relational pain of his father turning away from him when he was on the cross. And he did that so that we don't have to experience that. When we put our faith and trust in Jesus, then his death on the cross becomes a substitute for the penalty that we deserve. So, for all of you who have accepted Jesus as your Savior, think back to the first time you heard that, the first time you really understood that. Think about how that amazing act of love struck your heart. Think about how it changed you. Think about how it was just such an amazing act of love. See, this is what the writer is encouraging us to do, to think back to that moment, because this amazing truth can become dim in our hearts over the years because we're so familiar with it. But here we are encouraged to be inspired by going back to that time when we first understood what Jesus did for us and how we didn't deserve it. It was the supreme act of love. And that is inspiring. Okay, let's continue. Next verse. He goes on, remember how you remained faithful even though it meant terrible suffering. Sometimes you were exposed to public ridicule and were beaten, and sometimes you helped others who were suffering the same things. You suffered along with those who were thrown into jail, and when all you owned was taken from you, you accepted it with joy. This is an incredible passage, you know. Other parts of the Bible encourage us to look at the heroes of the faith for inspiration. For example, we're encouraged to look at the life of Moses or David or the Apostle Paul and draw inspiration from them. But there's a limit to that because we can be inspired by other people, but at the same time, we're aware that we don't have their talents and gifts and their circumstance and opportunities. And so it's easy for us to think, their example is inspiring, but I don't think I could ever do that. For example, I could watch LeBron James play basketball and be inspired. But at the same time, I wouldn't think that I could do what he can do because I don't have his talent. I hope that didn't shock you, but it's true. Anyway, so there's a limit to how much we can be inspired by other people. But here, the writer of Hebrews does something extraordinary. He says, no. Look back to your most enthusiastic time of serving Jesus. You see, the writer points out that there's a time when you loved and served others, even if there is great personal cost to yourself, because every act of love has a cost to it. Any real act of love costs us either our time or energy or money or something. Love has a cost. And he says, recall that time when you enthusiastically served Jesus by loving and serving people, absorbing the cost. Do you see what's going on here? Is he's encouraging us to make our former selves our faith heroes. And because we're looking at ourselves, then it is within our capabilities. It's a very practical way of inspiring ourselves. Many people who accept Jesus as their Savior start strong, and they serve with their whole hearts. And then over time, that enthusiasm dims. Well, look back at when your fire burned bright and be inspired by that example. Let's keep going. He continues, you knew there were better things waiting for you that will last forever. So do not throw away this confident trust in the Lord. Remember the great reward it brings you. Patient endurance is what you need now so that you will continue to do God's will. Then you will receive all that he has promised. You know, when I was a kid, I used to, maybe once a year, I'd get sick with strep throat. And I haven't gotten strep throat since I was, 11 or 12. It's been a long, long time. But back then, I used to get it once a year about. And when you got sick with strep back then, you had to go into the doctor and get two shots, a short-acting and a long-acting shot. And you got the shots not in the arms, okay? And I remember those shots, and they were probably the greatest pain I ever experienced up to that point in my life. I mean, they hurt bad. And, you know, they would take the bit of cotton and put alcohol on it and kind of disinfect the area first. That smell of alcohol to this day brings back those memories. And I used to whine and complain, and I didn't want to get those shots. But you know what? If I had strep, and it came down to it, I stood still and took the shots. Why? Because I knew that that's how I would get better. See, the point is, we can endure a lot if we are looking forward to something great on the other side. And this is what the writer of Hebrews is encouraging us to do, is to look ahead at what is waiting for us, the better life waiting for us. This is the example that Jesus gives to us. When Jesus went to the cross, it doesn't tell us he grit his teeth and toughed it out, but instead, look at this verse here from Hebrews 12. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor besides God's throne because of the joy waiting for him. What was the joy? Well, in that verse, part of it is just joining his Father in heaven on the throne. That was part of the joy. Another part of the joy was you, because enduring the cross was necessary for you and I, through faith in Jesus, to be reunited with his Father in heaven. You are part of the joy that he was looking forward to. And because of that, he could endure the horrors of the cross. And we can follow his example. No matter how long this crisis stretches on, or whatever happens in life, our Father in heaven has equipped us here. He has equipped us to be inspired, to get through this, standing strong and staying encouraged, drawing inspiration from what Jesus did for us on the cross, drawing inspiration by past versions of ourselves who served and loved others enthusiastically, enduring the cost, and finally drawing inspiration by looking ahead to the wonderful things waiting for us. So be inspired. And hang in there. Stand strong. Let's pray. Oh, Father, thank you, Lord, that Your son Jesus gives us such an amazing example to follow. So Lord, I ask for everyone listening today, you keep these truths vivid in our hearts, clear in our minds. Help us each, Lord, to stand strong, staying encouraged, with our hearts filled with love for you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at His feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty. The radiance of perfect love now shines for all to see. Your name is victory. No praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. No praise will rise to Christ our King. The fear that held us now gives way to Him who is our peace. His final breath upon the cross is now alive in me. Your name is victory. All praise will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to their soldiers watched in vain was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the
for you. Thank you so much for being with us today. If you could go to our Facebook page, Hometown Church, and like us and give us a follow. We're putting content up there to brighten your day throughout the week. If God puts it on your heart to give to our ministry, you can go to hometownchurch.com and give there. But more than anything, we hope you'll join us next week as we continue the series, Persevere. Have a wonderful week. Thanks.